18. I live in the neighborhood. I'm one of Mel's underlings, one of his many underlings. Okay. So today we gather to mourn for a Fillmore underdog, historian, entrepreneur, and community advocate, Mel Simmons. In the name of Sankofa, which is a word and symbol from the Akan tribe in Ghana, I think of Sankofa, I think of memories, specifically pictures. And we all know Mel was good at taking pictures.
Yeah.
It took Citizen Film and their Buchanan Project hours of scanning to archive his Fillmore memories, each photo possessing the Fillmore. I want to start the journey of healing for our loss through the pouring of ancestral libations. I'm doing water, and water is essential to the human vessel and all life on earth. Marcus Garvey. Booker T. Washington. Mary Ellen Pleasant. Frederick Douglass. Thomas Paine. Maya Angelou. Stella Baker. Rachel Townsend. Mel Simmons. Mel lives within us now, so let's make him proud until we see him again.
Davis, I'm the director of the San Francisco Human Rights Commission. My first role is a note from Mayor London Breed. So that means that it is for you all, and you can decide later after you read what she has said.
The thing that resonates the most with me that everybody has said is the smile. Mel's smile made you feel welcome and at home. He was the captain of, or the conductor of, the Underground Railroad to culture. It takes a special person to take art and culture and share it with other people in a way that they want to enjoy it. So just want to echo that. I know that the mayor, who was the previous director of the Art and Culture Complex, had tremendous love and admiration and appreciation for Mel. So again, thank you all so much for sharing him with us.
To the friends and family of Mr. Mel Vincennes, on behalf of the City and County of San Francisco, I would like to offer my sincerest condolences on the passing of our beloved Mr. Mel Vincennes. A true champion of our Fillmore community, Mr. Mel Vincennes, or as many of us knew him, Mel, touched and inspired the lives of all who had the pleasure of knowing him. He paved the way for countless San Franciscans to follow their artistic spirit wherever it may take them. He was an inspiration to those around him and will be deeply missed. I am confident that his family and friends he held dear will uphold his legacy and serve as true testaments of the lasting impact of his spirit. Please know that he had a lasting effect on those who knew him, and we are truly grateful for his life and contributions. With warmest regards, London Breed, Mayor.
Is we laughed a lot.
Oh, yes.
You know, I'm gonna be honest. I know I'm a preacher, but we laughed at people a whole lot. But I don't mind you laughing at me, because I have to face funny. I am funny most of the time. Most of us are. We get carried away over ourselves. And one of the things I remember so richly about Mel, he did not put himself up above other folk. Whatever.
That's it.
Yeah.
It's okay.
Yeah.
Whatever their condition may have been, he treated them like everybody else.
Yeah.
He was on the street, not because he had to be, because he wanted to be. Mel helped a whole lot of folk. Culture on the corner, y'all. Anybody remember that?
Yeah.
Culture on the corner.
Yes.
And teaching children to bring out the art that's in them. The real question you have to ask yourself, is the corner of the earth that I occupied while I was here better off or worse off for me having been in it?
Thank you.
Because your life ought to leave a mark.
Thank you.
And not a stain.
Thank you.
God bless y'all. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you to the family for sharing your loved one with us. You sent a beautiful human being to San Francisco,
and
for someone who has been deeply impacted by how he loved.
It was real.
Yes.
It was so real.
Yes.
It's real.
He taught me so much
about
compassion. And about how you look at people, how you see people. I needed him when I was there on Fillmore trying to figure out how to put art in the community and sustain a business. And I just turned around, he was sitting there smiling, you know? And we just started talking. It's like he never left my side. And so it's been an honor to know him, and it's been an honor to be able to express how much we love and care about him. So that the family who came all this way knows what this man did for Fillmore and San Francisco at large. So thank you.
Melanie, I'm Laura. We are the co-executive directors of the African American Art and Culture Complex. And so on behalf of, we call it the Center or AAACC, I just want to say, you know, for the two of us to be all the way from Memphis, Tennessee, we know what it's like to loan your family members and to never see them and to never really get what they do and what they mean to people. There are people right now in our family who think we're out here making movies, you know. So God knows what y'all thought Mel was doing. But I just want to thank you for sharing your loved one. He really represented you all well. He brought that Philly all the way to the Fillmo. He brought that love. He brought that swag. He brought that attention to detail, that rhythm, that flow. I wore my jeans for him today. And this hat, you could always count on wearing a dope hat. You know what I mean? So, say what? With the feathers. Exactly.
Or the little beanie.
Or the little beanie. Thank you, Mel, for being love. Thank you, Mel, for being love. And thank you all for sharing him with us. And I love everybody here. I know you through him. And I can feel you all right now. Please hug on someone.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Love is patient. Love is kind. Love is never selfish. Love is right on time.
Go ahead, Lance. We can hear you. Go ahead.
Oh, okay. peace and blessings to the community. All due respect to the family. Thank you guys so much for sending Mel our way. And I know Mel chose the safest place to come to San Francisco.
I arrived in San Francisco in 1972.
He chose the Pickwick Hotel, which is across the street from the San Francisco Met, the old Met building, which was one of the few places that survived the 1906 earthquake. So Mel knew what he was doing. He represented wisdom on the corner, and that brother always had something positive and useful to give you and tell you and say to you and try and encourage you and inspire you. And I really, truly appreciate it.
My name is Marcia, or as Mel called me, Marcy. Sweet name, sweet name. So I'm white, so I wrote it up. In so many small ways, Mel and I helped each other, cared about each other's well-being, served our community, including St. Francis Co-op, shared many laughs and cups of coffee, shared tears about our family and friends who started dying. Thank you, Mel, for sharing some of your time with me. I'll always cherish you in the times we spent making good trouble. I'm also white, so I have my papers. I met Mel through Marcia. They became fast friends, and it was a joy to be with them. Thank you, Mel, for being you. May your memory be a blessing, and may you rest in peace.
For black is not a color, but a hue, but a thing you wake up in the morning and do, but a shade for reminding the sun when it forgets, and the frat boy sons when they forget, and the old news when it forgets that you can hang a thing from an unsuspecting tree, you can poke it out its torso, you can name its babies missiles, Reverend Townsend, but you cannot undo it. Not now, not never. You cannot really make it gone. So we gonna get along. Maybe not like happy. Maybe not like peace. More like there's gravel in my knees. but I'm gonna dance it out. Carry the casket, plant the roses, read the plaque, me and my black body. Me in this fine suit, in this fine suit. And the words, 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 and the words that come with it. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
My name is William Rhodes. I'm an artist in the community. I arrived here in 2008, and I'm from Baltimore, Maryland, but I went to school in Philly, spent a lot of time in Philly. So
Morgan
I went
State.
Through. Yes, sir.
Morgan State.
All right, that's a beautiful school. I went through a lot of culture shock when I came here. I'm from a chocolate city, but I was walking down the street one day trying to put things together, and I ran into Mel Simmons. And the brother just had so much flavor from home. And I just immediately connected, again with the hats, you see. You know, I had to connect with him. And he took me under his wing. And I did a project where I've been going around interviewing people from the community and taking their portraits, putting them into quilts. It's called the African American Senior Quilt Project. And I went in one day and said to Mel, man, I gotta connect with some folks from the community. He said, meet me over at a Western Edition or the Queen Ada Senior Center. Interviewed Mel, and then he said, well, you gotta interview this guy, you gotta interview this woman. The blessing is, this is how the miracles work. The video guy who edited and put this all together, he called me up and he said, man, this is the freakiest thing. He said, you know, I'm trying to put some stuff together for Mel. But all of this footage that you gave me for the project that I was going to throw away, that we forgot about, this stuff was going to be thrown away because it didn't fit with the project I was doing. I discovered this just a couple of days before this ceremony took place. So again, I want to thank you all. And it's just, it's such a blessing being here. Blessings to all. Thank you.
Whatever the case may be, forgive. Practice loving people. I don't hate nobody. You're worth it.
Wow. This is a tough one for myself. I go back with Mel about 4 decades. And the first thing I admired about Mel was, you know, he had that East Coast Philly swag. It was just so cool, you know, and I was like, wow, I wish I could be like this guy, you know? And he took me under his arms, you know? He was a friend, he was a mentor, and he was a big brother to me. And he always, you know, reached out to me and connected with me and helped me. You know, he played a very instrumental part in my life. Growing up here in San Francisco, he showed me the way, how to be an entrepreneur. He would come and spend time with me and my family. He plays so many roles in this community. So one of the things I would say, he was always about this community and the kids. It's funny when they say, he would always have a line of kids behind him. Not only would he get a bus and take them to the rodeo,
yeah,
he would bring them out. Oh yeah, you went to the rodeo too, but you wasn't a kid, but you was there. You was right there with him all the time. Cowboy hat and all. And you talk about all the hats he had. My two sisters in crime here, and this young lady called me up and said, hey, you know, Mel's not doing well. You have to go see Mel. And I connected with these two ladies. And through that, I was able to meet my brother from another mother, his younger brother, Lenny. And this past year has been very tough, but I would just like to say I'm a missing. I truly appreciate him, and it was an honor to call him, like I said, my friend, my mentor, and my brother. And I just want to say that.
Whenever the Lord
Calvin was so, so kind. He taught me so much. He taught me how to sell clothes. I was in the clothing business for 30 years. He say, sis, you could go in the store and buy something on sale and take it home and resell it. Always keep your credit card. He would come visit me. Plus, we stayed the same age for 5 days. We were like twins. I said, okay, I could boss you for 5 days. He said, yeah, go ahead and boss me, but after that 5 days, cut it out. He never came empty-handed. He would always bring something for the kids. He was more than a brother to me. He was like my king. He was my everything. Him and I was on the bus, and I'm trying to save him bus money. It wasn't that much, $2 or $3. So I said to the bus driver, I said, well, do he have to pay? I said, he don't live here. I said, but he is a senior citizen. But why did I say that? He said, hey, girl, you tell your business and don't tell mine. I don't know what I'm gonna do without him. Danny, thank you. Because without you, all this wouldn't be possible. And so I'm gonna turn the mic over to her. This is my daughter, and her daughter came. I just loved him so much.
I wanted to give a special thank you to everyone who put this together. This was beautiful. And I could see my uncle smiling. The hats running my family, my grandfather. He wore his hats and suits. My uncle, I can't say enough about Uncle Lenny. I want to say thank you. You the bomb. You know that. I tell you this all the time. You put our family together, you hold it down. So cousin Fred, thank you. You are rolling. We roll together. He from North Carolina, and that's where our family is from, Kinston. So it was a lot of them, my grandfather. It was a lot of brothers, and they wore suits all day with their hats. So the class just runs all down our family. Thank you, Uncle Lenny. Thank you, Cousin Fred. Come over here, Fred, because he's a big part of our Simmons family.
I won't prolong this. We met at the family reunion, and I ain't going to tell you how it went, but Melvin came out there, and that's when I met him, and we became friends. Me and Mel used to get into it when I would tell him something he didn't want to hear. You know what he would say to me? Somebody's at my door. How can you get in his door when you got to ring the doorbell on the outside to go up the 44 steps to get to his door? Thanks to everybody for everything. And Leon, thank you.
Thank me.
Mickey. Thank you. But I will tell you, Melvin knew this was coming. 3-4 years ago, he started preparing himself for this. And he started giving away stuff. The piece of art that he gave me. Everybody said, well, where you get that from? I said, it's a long story. And they said, yeah, well, that's okay. If you're going to tell it, I don't want to hear it. I can't sing, but I can talk.
Thank you again. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello, Fillmore.
This may be a lesson for some, but I want you to hear my words very carefully. If you have a person that's in the medical community and they may be of color, you've got to make sure that the hospital community knows that they are a part of a family. You cannot leave them unattended. Make sure that the quality of care that you want for that person in your absence is ongoing. I'm not going to kid you when I say that I'm not so sure what your experiences are with General Hospital, but I can tell you what mine was. These folks called me every day, every night. Then all of a sudden I found out Melvin had given me two white sisters I knew nothing about. And they stepped in, and I swear I refer to them, and Herman does too, I call them gangsters. And they said, Lenny, we're your sisters that you knew nothing about. I'm like, okay. Not kidding you. I mean, I'm from Philly, so you know, I'm skeptical 24/7, okay? That's how I roll. So I'm like, okay. Yeah. And then, of course, I met Herman. And I don't know what it was about Herman, but you know when something goes like that? Yeah. Well, one day we're sitting down in a restaurant downtown, and I said, Herman, I said, when's your birthday? He said, September 24th. He said, when's yours? I said, September 23rd. He said, brother from another mother, he is not exaggerating, okay? That is true. That is my brother right there. Yeah, big brother, that's correct. Folks, the strokes were taking their tolls and still no answers. And then one day a miracle happened.
Thank you, Tom.
I call her a miracle. Because she came out of nowhere. She introduced herself. She said, hey, I'm Dr. Lisa Hu. I run Laguna. I heard about your brother. And she began to kind of go through Mel's medical history. Couldn't find any answers from what was in the computer system on Melvin. What this doctor did was she went and she summoned all the paper medical records of Mel Simmons that existed in San Francisco. They were stored in some warehouse somewhere. She went and she dug back into Melvin's history. And there it was. The pieces now were starting to come together. And come to find out, Melvin had suffered brain cancer back as far as 1999 and 2000. He stopped taking the chemotherapy because he didn't like how it made him feel. He got sicker, and he stopped. He started eating healthy and eating the right things. I think you talked about the fruits and the vegetables and all that. I think that's when all that came into play. And he actually made that work for him up until March 19th of 2022. Now that we knew what was causing his illness, on top of the fact that he also was a fighter of sickle cell anemia, I never saw my brother shed a tear. I never saw him beg for mercy. I never saw him complain about nothing. If you ask Mel, anytime you walked in and visited him, how are you feeling? How's it going? He said, I'm all right. I'm all right. I said, you sure, bro? He said, I'm all right. I said, okay. Back in November, the last time I actually saw him, and I was there, and this nurse walked in the room. And she walked in, and next thing you know, I saw his eyes open up. I was like, oh, okay. And she starts talking to him, and he's trying to communicate to her. He's doing more than I've ever seen in, like, months. And I'm like, okay, he's doing his best to communicate, and she's talking to him, and he's responding back to her. And I said, who are you? And she said, my name is Cece. I take care of your brother. I said, Okay, CC. And him and CC had that bond that I had never seen before. And it was such a bond that Dr. Who would call me, because Dr. Who and CC worked together. And she would call me in Philadelphia. She said, Lenny, how come CC can get Melvin to smile and laugh, but I can't? And I said, Dr. Who, please, don't worry about that. We did all we could. We did everything we could in our effort to try to return him back to you. I need for the Fillmore to understand that. I did not know about any of you 6 months ago. Through his death, through his illness, he has brought more people together than you could ever possibly imagine. I did not know the Mel that all of you know. I did not know that. And he would come to Philly and wouldn't say anything. We had no idea that he was and so involved and invested in the community. When I came out here in August, it was determined that Mel could not live where he was living at any longer, because it was 44 steps that he had to go up to get to his place. He wasn't going to do that anymore. So a quick decision was made. We got to shut this place down, get his items put into storage, and just now deal with him over at Laguna, because that was going to be his new place. Met with Herman and Osaka. Marcus's mother, Osako, my brother's longtime companion and wife. And Brother Herman came to me and said, hey, Lenny, he said, I got a message from you. I'm like, what is it? Now, mind you, before I left Philly, I had moving trucks in place. I had storage facility already in place. Everything was locked in about where Mel's stuff was going to go. And so he said, Lenny, there's two sisters that told me to give you a message. I said, what's that? I said, whatever the cost of your expense of moving, I'm going to take that receipt from you, and they'll take care of it. And I'm like, here we go again. These people, where are these people coming from? And I said, who are you talking about? He said, their name is Melanie and Melora. I said, well, where are they? He said, don't worry about it. So we worked that day, and we got the receipt from the movers and everything. Herman took the receipt out of my hand. I looked at him, he ran down the steps, and gone for about 5 minutes, came back up the steps, all 44 of those steps, and he said, it's all taken care of, it's done, it's paid for. And I was like, what? And he said, yeah, he says, it's took care of me. I want to say thank you to them and for the unwavering support of providing the assistance, the care, the love. I'll say love again. And you introduced another piece to my life, which is that sister Sherry Miller. Put the dot over top of the I on everything that we've been doing for the last year. That's what I call it, the dot. She did. Fred Cadet is the cousin that Mel would call in North Carolina, and those two would chit chat and chat up a storm. I can't talk as much as Fred, because Fred will keep you on the phone for it. Because Fred is the historian of the family. And I'm honored to be his cousin. Melvin was honored to have you as our cousin, because you, brother, are the one that keeps us together. Can I get CC and Dr. Who to come up, please? Mm.
The doctors came. Wow.
But I want to say to CC, thank you for taking care of my brother. Thank you for keeping a smile on his face. And he's a part of the family. And I thank you so much. I can only pray that all of the patients that receive your care will understand what you offer as a person that showed a love for their patients. So I want to thank you for that. And Dr. Liu, Dr. Lisa Liu, I just wanted to, first of all, I miss our phone calls. Yeah, I miss our phone calls. We got to know families and everything, and then my wife would be at home at 9:30 on a Wednesday, and my wife would say, "It's Lisa."
Say hi, Maria.
She would say, "It's Maria." So please put that on your desk. And no, thank you. This is just the beginning, because you hit a grand slam. And I just want to say thank you so much for your generosity, your support during this time. And I hope you accept this small token from us, something for you to look at and remember as much as possible what Mel Simmons was all about and what our family was all about. And what we want to say to you is thank you. 1,000 times, thank you. Sherry, I'm going to miss these calls, sister. I'm going to miss the directness and getting things in order and just driving everything home and getting it to where we are here today. Never quite seen anything as dynamic as you are, as tight as you are, and the things that you do. So thank you so much. So on behalf of the family, I'm gonna jump on a boat under the Golden Gate Bridge, and I'm gonna sprinkle his ashes in that water. There's a reason for that. Melvin don't belong to Philadelphia. He don't belong to Philly. Melvin belongs to San Francisco. He belongs to the Fillmore. And every single time you go over that Golden Gate Bridge, that Bay Bridge, or you walk along the coast, or you drive along the coast, I want you to feel him. He's staying out here with you. When I fly out Monday, I'm gonna look at that water. I'm gonna feel good that I left him right there. I want him to be here, I want him to be home. I also want you to know that he's there and you look after him as he's looking after you.
I know what happiness is. The love of your family, your brother, your little sister, whatever. Take them for a walk. Hold that hand. You know what I mean? Hug that. Hug that. Thank you.
do. I'm not exaggerating. Thank you from the Simmons family. Thank you.